Well, good morning. Welcome to church today. Thank you for being faithful to be in your place this morning. It's right at 10 o'clock. We want to start sharply and give our choir enough time for the Christmas cantata. They are this morning singing the song of joy, and I know it's going to be a great blessing to you. If you have your Bibles, Isaiah's the book we're looking at, Isaiah chapter 7. And if you don't have a Bible, you can look on the screen just behind me. We're going to be looking at Isaiah chapter 7 and also Isaiah chapter 9. Once you find your place, let's all stand together this morning. Isaiah chapter 7, we're going to read from two passages. I'll read verse 14, then we'll all read verses 6 and 7 together. And again, this is in reference to the coming of the Lord Jesus. Isaiah writes, "Therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace." And on the last verse, "Of the increase of his government and peace there shall be no end, upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom, to order it and to establish it with justice and justice from henceforth even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this." Dear Lord Jesus, we thank you that we can gather today. Lord, as many are preparing for Christmas, preparing for travel, preparing, Lord, for what they're going to do with their family, Lord, thank you that we can gather as a church family to remember why you came and, Lord, what your coming means to us today. Lord, we do pray that you would help us as we hear the songs of joy that are going to be sung this morning, to know that we have the joy of the Lord in our hearts and present in our lives. Lord, we just pray for those this morning that are in discouragement. They are dealing with great difficulties. Whatever, Lord, they're facing, we pray that today, Lord, through your word and through the word that is sung, that you would just lift their spirits, you would encourage their hearts, and Lord, you would remind us all why you came, and Lord, that you said you are coming again. Lord, may we be ready, and it's in Christ's name we ask all these things. Amen.
So we're going to sing a song of joy about Jesus. This musical is all about Jesus. Listen now.
The celebration of the coming of the Christ child. A big part of our celebration of Christmas each year are the songs we sing. Silent night, joy to the world. Oh, come all ye faithful. And then there's this one. Come, thou long-expected Jesus, born to set thy people free, born thy people to deliver, born a child and yet a king. Let us remember that these are more than just words of a Christmas hymn we sing once a year. This was the prayer prayed for centuries by God's people who were longing for a Savior. And now we rejoice. Their prayers were answered. Christ, our Redeemer, has come. And the story of how and why he came is the story we tell today. In the little village of Bethlehem, there lay a child one day. And the sky was bright with a holy light o'er the place where Jesus lay.
Joyful, joyful, all ye nations, glory to the newborn. God of all the dawn of Eden, before the fall of man, he whispered it to David. It's in the songs he'd sing, words about the Son of God, the long-awaited King. He spoke to Isaiah a prophecy so wild, no one could imagine a virgin with a child. And he revealed to Micah a wonderful man, a ruler and Messiah who would come from Bethlehem, that the world soon be born to her, that the world may know the heart of heaven, a son to show God longs to seek and save us, and from age to age untold the story still unfolds, how the Father loves us so.
Time for the taking of the census as decreed by Caesar Augustus, and thus all of the streets and inns and other public places in and around Bethlehem were filled with activity. Somewhere amid the busyness and chaos, there came in the moment a holy hush, a silent night. A child was born, Son of God, love's pure light, lying in a manger, sleeping in heavenly peace, Jesus our Lord at his birth.
Silent night, holy
Stretches forth his loving hand, reaching out to find you here in your very own silent night.
All is calm and all is bright everywhere, but in your heart tonight, they're singing carols of
Christmas is a time for invitations. We receive them in all sorts of ways, through the mail, via text and social media, by phone, face to face. Invitations to come celebrate the season with those we love are everywhere around us. Invitations have always been a part of the Christmas story. The angels appearing to the shepherds, inviting them to come to Bethlehem to see the newborn king. A cosmic invitation appearing in the heavens as a bright star, inviting the wise men to come and seek the Christ child. We hear it in the songs we sing. Come to Bethlehem and see. Come, all ye faithful. Come and behold him. Come, let us adore him. Here tonight, he extends an invitation to us to go beyond the imagery of the babe lying in a manger, inviting you to come to him here and now, just as you are. Jesus is waiting for you to respond to his invitation, to know him in the fullness of his grace and acknowledge him as Lord and Savior. Invite him to come into your heart, to rule and reign as Lord of your life. Come now, worship the King.
Come out of sadness, from wherever you've been. Come brokenhearted, let rescue begin. Come find your mercy, O sinner, come kneel. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has
In the bleak midwinter, all creation's groan for a world in darkness, frozen like a stone. Light is breaking in a stable for a throne,
and he shall reign forevermore, forevermore,
and he shall reign forevermore, forevermore. Unto us a child is born, the King of kings and the Lord of lords, and he shall reign forevermore, forevermore. If I were a wise man, I would travel far. And if I were a shepherd, I would do my part. But poor as I am, I will give to him my heart.
And he shall reign forevermore, forevermore.
And he shall reign forevermore, forevermore.
Unto us a child is born, the King of kings and Lord of lords. And he shall reign forevermore, forevermore. Hear
look there if you would, Philippians chapter 4. And Paul is writing here, and he says in this text here, as he's writing this letter, rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. And the one thing that's so remarkable about this particular letter and this certain statement is that Paul is writing this letter from a prison cell. So Paul is writing to the church, and he's telling them that they need to, and they can, with confidence, rejoice or have joy in the Lord. And not only does he say it one time, he says, rejoice in the Lord always, and again, I say rejoice. And that's not a suggestion that Paul has given to the church, but he's given them a command. Now, Paul, who is sitting in the prison cell, his circumstances, and I would even say, can we just, in context here, our circumstances, even this morning, it sometimes doesn't cause you to have joy. But our joy, as we're going to see biblically, is not based upon the externals. It's not based upon the happenings around us or the circumstances. A good way to look at this is happiness depends on happenings, but joy that is eternal is based on Christ. Two particular quotes I found fascinating. Number one, C.S. Lewis said this, joy must be sharply distinguished from both happiness and pleasure. You know, our world is in a rapid pace, a frantic search for something that will bring them satisfaction. The second quote I thought was interesting, a little more simple, says, happiness is a drive-through window, but joy is a continual feast. You know, in pursuit of things that matter and things that will fill them up, the world goes through the drive-through windows of this society, of this age, trying to fill their bellies, their cars, their lives with stuff. And ultimately, all we see is that joy, abiding eternal joy, is found in Christ. So it's plain to see that our world has no joy and is searching for happiness. That is no more evident than when you just look at the songs of this world. So in preparation for this thought, and to contrast what the choir was going to sing about and will sing about, a song of joy, I looked at the Billboard's top three songs for 2022. Now, some of you might know these songs already. You might have heard of these. You might have even heard them played on the radio. But the Billboard's top three songs, maybe in your mind you already have an inkling. Between these top three songs on YouTube alone, there are over 3 billion views just on YouTube, not counting Instagram, Snapchat, or TikTok. These three songs and their, I guess, being put out into the public forum were before 2022, but they have so elevated in people's minds these particular themes that even right now, as of December the 18th of 2022, they're still number one, number two, and number three. What are they? Well, they tell an interesting story about our world. Again, contrasted with a song of joy. Here are the songs. The first number one song is Heat Waves by Glass Animals. Number two, As It Was by Harry Styles. And number three, Stay, which is by a rapper known as The Kid and Justin Bieber. There, again, are almost 3 billion views. You say, now, what do these songs talk about? Well, Dave Bailey, who is the writer and the singer of the number one song, Heat Waves, says this song is a sad song with feelings of loss about the breakdown of a relationship. Despite being unable to get over it, he recognizes that his romance has failed, and parting ways in this relationship is for the best. Quote, in the chorus and in the verses, you just need a better life than this. You need something I can never give. He admits his failure and a bittersweet breakup and says, sometimes all I think about is you, late nights in the middle of June. The second number one song, or the second song on Billboard's top 100 for this year, is written by Harry Styles, and the title of the song is As It Was. When he was asked about this particular song and what it meant, he said this, the song is based on my experience during the pandemic, during the lockdown, when I was forced to slow down. Something happened to me. I wasn't a musician anymore. I was a friend, a brother, and a son. I had a lot of time during the lockdown to sit and think about and work out who I was away from music. And with everything that happened in the pandemic, it's so obvious that it's just never going to be the same as before. You can't go back, whether it's us collectively or me in my personal life or any of those things. The top song, number three, Stay, by this rapper known as The Kid and Justin Bieber, the lyrics are a little darker, I'd say, than the other two. But the author, or the writer, is and the singer, is wasting his life. and needs the girl he loves to stay balanced in his life and to live properly. Here's a quote from the song. I get drunk, I wake up, I'm wasted still. I realize the time I've wasted here. I feel like you can't feel the way I feel. He goes on and says that he gets lost in some very bad habits. He's clearly living alone and feeling the need to gain control. And to do that, he says, I need her. That's why he says in the chorus, I do the same thing. I told you that I never would. I told you I changed even when I knew I never could. I know that I can't find nobody else as good as you. I need you to stay. I need you to stay. These are the top three songs in our world presently. Now, you probably randomly have heard these things going into a store, on the radio, or on a commercial. But our world is searching for happiness, and you can look no further than just to the playlist of many people and find out that they are in a desperate search to find meaning in life and something that will bring true happiness. So why on Sunday morning am I talking about Harry Styles, Justin Bieber, and glass animals? I mean, you're like, I didn't need to know that information. Well, a lot of people do. A lot of people know this, and their lives are consumed by it. And, of course, not only celebrities and entertainers and athletes and politicians, but also many of us, the common folk. We see that happiness is something that is elusive for so many in this world. And it's really on the playlist of many sinners and saints alike. The noise of this world is appealing at times, we can see, but its tunes can only temporarily drown out our problems. It can put a short spring in our step and even momentarily conceal our pain. I still think about 1987 of the fair in Lowndes County. This is Valdosta. My father had come to work at a church, and we were only there for a brief time. And I grew up in the Carolinas, and so coming to South Georgia for a brief time was interesting from someone who was from the sticks and the mountains. And I remember going to the fair in that area at the time, and we got on the Gravitron, my friend Jason and I. His name was Jason. I hang out with guys that got cool names. And our friends, we got on the Gravitron, and there was a song playing, Living on a Prayer, Bon Jovi. Again, it was the 80s and playing. And again, I grew up in a fairly sheltered home, so we didn't really, listen to a lot of the music of the world. And again, back then, you just had the radio. You didn't have much else, and a record player, 8-track player. But I remember hearing that song, and any time now that even comes on, whether it's the radio, it's a commercial, my mind goes back to that crazy Gravitron, the fair in Valdosta in 1987. Music has an appeal, it has an allure, and sometimes it gives an escape for people. It helps them to get away from things that seem hard. I would say this, the songs of this world state the obvious. What do they say? Present pain is real and raw, but there's no true escape from it. My past hurts and haunts me, keeps me from living in the present and fearful of the future. Love is real but unreachable, therefore I'll never have it, and if I do, I might ruin it. Heaven and hell are real, but we create them here and now, and most often I live in hell with no hope of ever experiencing heaven. And as we see, music is an expression of the human heart and soul. Everyone has some kind of a song on their heart or in their mind. And maybe right now, even if we went to your smartphone or to your car or whatever, you've got a playlist or you've got songs that really mean a lot to you. They speak to you. They say something to you. But what we're saying this morning as the choir is singing and as they're presenting this, a song of joy, it really transcends even what this world has to offer. The worldly themes can only describe the painfully obvious without answering the most critical questions of our lives. And here are the questions. Who am I? Why am I here right now on this planet? What is my purpose for living? Why does it hurt so much in my life? Will things get better? Is there more to life? Is this the end? And am I loved? You hear these themes throughout the songs of this world, but really with no genuine answer. And that's why it's so imperative, as Paul is writing from a prison cell to this particular church. He says that in the closing chapter, rejoice in the Lord. He says, and again I say, rejoice. He is telling the church, despite your circumstances, despite what's going on around you in the world, despite what you're feeling about those things, you can with confidence and on purpose rejoice in the Lord. That word rejoice simply means to have joy in the Lord. So the birth of Jesus, you know this, and you're going to read it to your family. We're going to talk about it next Sunday morning, and it's all throughout the media, perhaps, getting downplayed. But the birth of Jesus, the announcement, it said, "Fear not, I bring you good tidings of great joy." So you got to think of this, that the very announcement of the birth of the Savior, His entrance into this world in physical form, the birth of Christ, was one that was announced, good tidings with great joy, meaning joy that is not based on circumstance, because He came into a very dark world at a very dark time. The nation of Israel was in oppression. They were under the boot of the Roman government. And when Christ came, He wasn't born in a palace. He wasn't born to a king. He was born in a stable, really in a cave, in a manger, surrounded by animals. And this young woman and her husband, a carpenter, both very poor. There was no place even for them. So how can you find joy in that? And we look at our lives, and even at this time, have you noticed that when you go to Walmart or Target or Kohl's or wherever it is that you shop, Home Depot or Lowe's, there are fewer things on the shelves, and the things that are there cost more than they did last year. There's not a lot of joy about that or happiness. When you see the index of the mortgage prices or of the price of cars or of fuel or whatever it might be or of food, Jesus came into a very dark time. There was not a lot of happiness. There was a lot of crying. There was a lot of misery. There was a lot of occupation. And yet Jesus came in and it says, "I'm bringing you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people." In contrast to the worldly themes that I just mentioned, and again, I only gave you the top three, I descended that list, and the further down you go, the rougher the songs get, and the darker they are. But that is the song. Music is the language of many in our world, and they are expressing what is here and trying to make sense of their lives and trying to get people to understand who they are and what they're dealing with. But in contrast to the worldly themes that we hear today, biblical songs have a central theme and figure. They teach us how to live, how to love, and how to die. Biblical songs show me who I am without God. But most importantly, biblical songs show me who God is, why He came, how much He loves, and that I have a reason to live. A song of joy. Jesus came, the Bible says, that you might have life and have it more abundantly. When we listen to or look at the songs of this world, and I'm saying it generally speaking, of course, there's some positive music out there, but ultimately songs that are based on God's Word, they reveal something not just about who we are, because if the worship is centered in us and man or woman or in our needs simply, we forget who our Creator is and what He wants for us and what He wants from us. In fact, we can say Christians, because of this song of joy, we have something to shout about. We can shout on purpose. Thus Paul's words, "Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice." So here's the contrast as we're going to, in just a moment, enjoy the rest of the cantata. Biblical joy, which is eternal, is based on Christ. When my externals change and the feelings of happiness fade, I can have confidence that my foundation of joy will last because it's based on who Jesus is and what Jesus did. You know, my feelings... And I said to the Sunday school class this morning, I've had a week. Can I just see by a show of hands, how many of you at some time in the past, you've had a week? Yeah. And part of the week, which a week is 7 days, and one of those days, I had a week within a day. Do you get what I'm saying here? It was, and I've told my wife that several times. I mean, when we're talking, I'm like, it's been a week. I've had a week. Oh, see, and there we go. Okay. We've had a week. It's been rough. It's been tough. But happiness depends on happenings, but joy is not based on the externals, how I feel about it, or actually what truly is. Because what truly is, it should not dictate the eternals, which is that God loves me, Christ came to seek and to save the lost,
and He has a plan for my life. So how can we rejoice in a broken world? Because the basis, the motivation, and the object of our joy and rejoicing is Christ. It's based on the eternal, not the external. Not on situations I cannot control and feelings which eventually change. Jesus never will change. And the writer in the New Testament says that's Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever. You know, the music of this world, although much of it, I mean, it takes us back to the gravitron. It takes us back to our childhood. It takes us back to a wonderful memory or a sad memory. It draws us back. When we think of what Christ has done for us and His entrance into this world at a very dark time, we can see that, as Nehemiah mentioned to the people in his day, the joy of the Lord is your strength. He's not saying to Christians, you need to muster something up. Stiff upper lip. Just come on, suck it up, buttercup. You need to do something better with this. That's not what he's saying for Christians. If I have to muster it myself, I'm going to be in a bad way. It's going to be a long week. But my joy, my true satisfaction, that longing that this world looks after and is seeking for, I can find in Jesus, because Jesus is the one that never changes. He is the anchor to our soul. He is the song of joy. This theme of joy is underscored by the use of 59 times the word is used of joy and 74 uses of rejoicing in the New Testament alone. And it signifies a feeling of happiness based on spiritual realities. So let's talk about that for a second. Have you had a flat tire? Has your engine blown? Is your washing machine broke? Are you broke? What is it like wherever you are? All of these physical realities sometimes go before our spiritual realities, which is, I'm saved. He found me. I am forgiven. I have a home. I have a family. I have new life. I have grace. I've been all of these things. And although those things, they don't seem tangible, because who doesn't want $100? Who doesn't want to have their mortgage paid? Who doesn't want to have these things work out for our health, our home, and our happiness? But the spiritual realities are things that you can't put a price on. And that is where we find our joy and satisfaction in Jesus. Finally, the Bible says this in Hebrews chapter 12, that joy in Christ brings rest. Chapter 12 of Hebrews, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before Him, going to the cross, giving His life, being cussed at, being beaten, being slapped, being spit upon, being mocked, being criticized, being crucified, the joy that was set before Him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider Him that endured such contradiction of sinners against Himself, lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds. Unless we had an example who, for the joy set before Him, went through it and endured it, that would be us. We would be the top three Billboard songs. We would identify with those themes in this world. I don't know if I'm going to make it. It's never going to be the same again. And we opine for days where things were better. Yes, I miss some of those days. But by the way, what a day that will be when my Jesus I will see, when I look upon His face. You know, that is good. This is rough. But there will be a day when I will see the Lord face to face, when the cares and the pain and the issues of this life, the long weeks that we've all had, will just kind of fade from our view. So Christ is the basis, the motivation, and the source of our joy. What He did and not what I have done. Someone put it this way: the joy of the Lord is a thermostat, not a thermometer. Now, we have these new digital thermostats on the property. We did this last year. And so I could go to my phone, and Pastor Chris can do the same, and we can, and it's great, because often, well, pre-Wi-Fi around the property, you had to come in to make sure really early, especially this building, make sure it's heated or it's cooled. But now I could sit on my couch at home. I could be at the hospital in Gainesville. I could be in North Carolina and see, what's the temperature in the church? I think I'll play around. No, I don't do that. But I can do that. But someone said the joy of the Lord is a thermostat, not a thermometer. A thermometer reveals conditions. A thermostat controls them. Happiness is related to the thermometer. If your happiness is good, you're happy. If it's bad, you're unhappy. And your condition of happiness goes up and down with your circumstances, but joy remains constant in Christ because He is our thermostat that never changes. What is this Christmas, this year, really depending on in your life? What someone has said, what someone has done, what someone has not done or has not said, the way it has gone, what the president, the administration, the government, whatever it might be, your job, your health, your doctor, your kids, your parents, whatever. We're all affected by it. That doesn't mean that it's going to be easy. When we think about COVID and how we came through this, we mentioned this in Sunday school. You remember, everyone, stop the spread. Stop the spread. You know what's interesting about joy? Joy is something the Bible talks about as being contagious. There are certain things we want to stay away from. You remember what it was like during COVID? Someone would sneeze and you'd look at them like, you all right here? Why are you here? Why are you out? What are you doing? And people would look at you kind of funny. Joy is contagious. People that have joy in their heart, even though they might not have a lot of things in their hand, in their garage, or in their home, joy in their heart. But the adverse is also true. Bitterness, anger, regret, being sour, that's also contagious. And that's something that is easily caught when you're around those folks. But joy, which comes from the Lord and is eternal, is not something that I can muster up, something that I can just make up myself. And that's something that these artists, celebrities, athletes, politicians all need. They need Jesus. We can just look at their choices, their actions, their passions, and their playlists. Rejoicing in the Lord is an action, not a feeling. God chooses what we go through, but we get to choose how we go through it. Well, there was a church in Omaha, Nebraska. They say, I don't know if this is true, they say the church was Presbyterian, but I'm not sure what denomination it was, and thus maybe this pastor story, since it was Presbyterians, they can't shout or say amen, but I've been plenty of Baptist churches where they don't shout or say amen either. Can I say it? Get an amen there? But there was this conference in Omaha, Nebraska, and upon entering this conference at this church, particular church service, everyone in the church was given a balloon at the door, and it was helium filled. So you can imagine this morning, you can kind of look around the room. The choir has their balloon. You have your balloon. It'd be kind of an odd sight. But upon entering, they were told, when you have this balloon, if any time during the service, the conference, you just want to express how you feel about the Lord and how good God is, just let your balloon go. And all throughout the service, there was songs, there was a challenge, all this. Balloons were being released all over. There were no amens, no hallelujahs, no praise the Lord, but balloons were kind of flying up. You know what, Pastor Chris, that's a great idea. We'll do that. That will keep you on your toes. So, come to the new cutting-edge church. We hand out balloons at the door. Clowns after the service, balloons at the door. But sadly, at the end of service, one-third of those balloons had not even been released. Now, you think about this. The pastor who shared that story simply said this: let your balloon go. Rejoice in the Lord. You have something to shout about? I think we do. Although we can't shout in our happenings, in our circumstances, often in our health, in our situation, I can let the balloon go. I don't even have to have a balloon to say praise the Lord. I can, Lord, my joy is based on the eternal, not the external, and my internal joy is based in you. What is your joy based on? A song of joy. Let's pray this morning. Dear Lord Jesus, as we come to hear the choir carry on this thought of joy and what you bring by your first coming, Lord, I pray that you would remind us that joy, true happiness, is only found in you. And those who are seeking after the things of this world as it was, looking for relationships or fulfillment or satisfaction, whatever it might be, Lord, remind us that we can find it in you, that, Lord, we need to look to you, and, Lord, we can be found in you. Bless your word this morning, Lord, and bless the choirs that are about to sing, and it is in Christ's name we pray. Amen.